Biodiversity refers to the variety of life on Earth, and the term covers ecosystems, species, as well as the genetic level. We may not realize it, but biodiversity is crucial for human well-being and livelihoods. It is essential resources and ecosystem functions that sustain life on the planet. It supports, for instance, food production, purification of air and water, climate stabilization, and advances in human health. The main expected outcome of the UN Biodiversity Conference is a new Global Biodiversity Framework to replace the Strategic Plan for Biodiversity and its Aichi targets, which, let's say, expired in 2020. And all reviews show that the international community hasn't been particularly successful in their implementation. The new framework now aims to catalyze and enable urgent and transformative action by governments as well as other societal actors to address biodiversity loss. At this stage, the draft framework contains several sections, including, importantly, 22 action targets to be achieved by 2030. Addressing issues ranging from protected areas and species overexploitation to pollution and climate change impacts, and from benefit sharing and management of biotechnologies to finance, harmful subsidies, and participation in decision making, to name but a few. A main area of divergence among parties concerns the cross-cutting item of benefit sharing from the use of digital sequence information on genetic resources. And this is a term which is used to refer to the information content of the resources used in bio-based research and development. The participation of indigenous peoples and local communities in policies and regulations concerning access and benefit sharing has been particularly complex, as well as the protection of traditional knowledge. The issue of digital sequence information complicates even further these matters. The representatives of indigenous peoples and local communities really wish to ensure their full and effective participation in all the discussions concerning digital sequence information. I think the main problem is that the whole research and development process gets even further away from the traditional stewards of biodiversity that have been indigenous peoples and local communities. And that's the fundamental fear there. Other crucial areas for agreement concern resource mobilization and the availability of finance, and mechanisms for monitoring, assessment, and the review of implementation. The delays due to the pandemic, I think they have been both good and bad. I mean, good because they allowed for significant consultations and significant improvement of understanding of the main issues to be resolved, and for advances in particularly difficult matters such as digital sequence information. On the other hand, first of all, it's difficult to actually reach consensus over virtual meetings. Second, it is difficult to maintain the momentum if the planet goes through such an emergency, such as a global pandemic. It has definitely uncovered new issues. I mean, for instance, the linkages between biodiversity and human health are much clearer now. So this could provide the impetus for further political action. Now, when it comes to the actual draft, I see two categories of issues to be resolved. First, there are the main political issues that I mentioned already, like agreement on digital sequence information, like finance and resource mobilization, indigenous peoples, protected areas, etc. Then there is significant technical work to be done. There are many, many provisions that are not so controversial per se, but the language still need to be agreed and clarified. So if you look at the draft, it is still mainly in brackets. If it's going to be a Paris moment for biodiversity, I guess people mean that this meeting may provide the opportunity for biodiversity to receive the political attention that it needs compared to climate change, that it currently lacks, and to inspire political will and political action.